Hello again, History of Christianity students. This is Doc Matthews in the Shack of Knowledge. It's the middle of March, which means several things. It means that we're expecting another snowstorm here in Clover Valley, with the usual March foot of snow that we get sometime around mid-March on a, I don't know if there even is a typical year anymore. So I've got a raging fire going and a hot beverage by my elbow. It also means, if it's the middle of March, that it's time to discuss early issues with what would come to be called the Trinity, this idea that God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This begins, really, in the second century, and we're going to be tracing these discussions over the next few lectures. If you're following along on the PDF version of the notes, please note that this constitutes the first third of the lectures labeled as History of Christianity, or HisChris, number 5. I've divided them into three because there's a lot of deep stuff here. My dog has been evicted from the Shack of Knowledge, so apologies if you hear her complaining outside about the about her excommunication. But when she was in here, she was doing nothing but complaining anyway, either begging for treats or offering unsolicited theological opinions on the Trinity, or in her most recent complaint, complaining that it was too hot. So she's now outside and actually sleeping contentedly in a snowdrift, as very furry dogs are wont to do. But if she disrupts things, you may be hearing her in the background. Logos theology. The idea of the Logos is something we've been discussing and wrestling with since the very early days of this course. At the heart of the earliest Christian teaching, even in the New Testament, I could say especially in the New Testament after all our discussions of the Gospel of Mark, Christ is portrayed as both divine and a mediator between God and man. For two handy references, if you're into looking things up in the Christian scriptures, check out 1 Timothy 2:5 and Galatians 3:19 and 20, but there's a great deal more that you could look at. The paradox of Jesus being both divine and something separate enough from the Father to be called a mediator was satisfied with the language of Stoicism and Middle Platonism, as we've discussed earlier on in the course, in which Christ could be portrayed as the Stoic Logos, or the personified divine reason. Divine reason was both identical with God and proceeding from God in Christian theology. One of the early metaphors that you find in Origin of Alexandria is that the Son proceeds from the Father as light from a candle. You can check this out in John chapter 1 as well. The Gospel of John begins with Jesus proceeding from the Father. Now, later generations will suggest that the light proceeding from a candle analogy lends itself to heresy, if not being heresy itself. Later generations get a bit too wrapped up with Aristotelian categories, I think. The idea that you get with light from a candle is that there is an origin of the light, and there is something preceding, which is the light itself. This is very much the doctrine of how the Father relates to the Son in later discussions, in the 4th century, as you will see, before we get to the second test, I promise. So this light from a candle analogy is something I'd like you to hold on to. I think we can get wrapped up in the idea of, is there a good analogy for the Trinity? And the answer is no, because the Trinity is a mystery which transcends the ability of created human reason to understand. This was simply accepted in the early church. But when using analogies, analogies help to explain what the Trinity is not, which is any number of other things excluded by the analogy. So we're going to keep using the certain analogies as a way of discussing the Trinity, with the understanding that none of them are perfect. For the most part, then, Christians simply accepted the idea that the Logos and the Father are both one God as a mystery, which was possible because God transcended the normal limits of time and space. Human reason is not capable of grasping something being one and two, well, outside of certain mathematical concepts. For those of you who may be math majors, you're aware that something can be both one and two once you get past basic arithmetic. But the reality here is that a Christian could be a monotheist believing in a single God and yet believing in some type of distinction between Father and Son, and ultimately the Holy Spirit, whom we're not talking about at the moment, as a single God. So hold on to that. There was a great deal more flexibility of mind than later generations are capable of, I'm afraid, including our own. In the writings of Justin Martyr and a few others, it appeared as if too much has been said. Here I have to disagree with chapter 8, where I think they have a really harsh reading of Justin Martyr. I don't believe that Justin ever did hold that Christ was a creature made by God, the way they portray it there. Justin uses a lot of different language to explain something that is fundamentally to him a mystery, the divinity of Christ and the idea that Father and Son represent one God. Justin's claim that Christ was a God alongside God, also, poor use of language perhaps, it appeared to go against the concept of monotheism, that there is only one God. And he describes Christ as divine alongside the Father. Now, there's a number of ways of translating and interpreting that concept of being alongside. And the most, I think, reasonable way to translate and interpret that concept of divinity alongside divinity is the way that Justin was understood in the 4th century by his readers then, who understood him to be actually a defender of the idea of Christ's full divinity with the Father, not a subordinationist, as the textbook suggests. To be balanced, then, Justin's defenders, and I am one of them, pointed out that he was working within the limits of earthly categories and language to defend a mystery. And this was not the point that he was making. Justin is also defending a mystery to people who have no understanding whatsoever of the Christian scriptures. Most of his discussions of these things occur in discourses with people who are not Christians. So he's going to use analogies that are going to get him through that discussion. He's not sitting down, in other words, to write doctrine. He's not concerned with that. He's concerned with defending the faith, and he's concerned with establishing what Christians are not, which is worthy of death, as we've seen when we read the Second Apology. So it's a bit far, I think, for the textbook to take Justin and to give him some type of rigorous doctrinal reading when he wasn't involved in that himself. And Justin had defenders from the very beginning. You know, he certainly doesn't need me to be his defender. And I encourage you, if you're wondering what Justin really said and how it fits within the context of these discussions, to talk to me about possible further reading on this issue. Now, the textbook gives you a very good summary of what monarchianism was as a group of related heresies, of course, as what they were called by the early Christians, who regarded themselves as not part of these movements. They themselves didn't think of themselves as heretics. That should go without saying, but every so often I have to say it just to be sure. There's nothing objective about that title. But monarchian, you can see the concept of monarch in there, or the idea of a single headship, a single rulership. And all three of these heresies could be labeled monarchian, because over against the idea of a duality or even a trinity in the Godhead, they maintained an absolute assertion of monotheism as they defined it, as being the answer to who God is and what God did in terms of the incarnation. Beginning at the turn of the 3rd century, several groups were bothered by the paradox of monotheism and the distinction between Christ and the Father. They were never a majority. They were a very small minority, as far as I can tell, but they were very vocal minorities who tried to solve the problem in different ways, all appealing to human reason in a way that would be considered heretical by those who rejected these points of view. And we'll talk on that further. A reminder, please take notes and store up especially questions on these issues. This ain't easy stuff, folks. And I want you to have questions ready for the class discussion, because I can go into any of these topics a great deal further if you feel it's necessary for your understanding. All of these groups were monarchianists, concerned with preserving the power and authority of the one supreme God. The first group, the Adoptionists, as they've been called, are associated with a fellow by the name of Theodotus, who himself was a tanner. He tanned animal hides from Byzantium, and he made his way to Rome. The movement he began gained ground in Rome around 190. He argued that Jesus was a mere human being on whom the power of God descended at the baptism. What was going on when the heavens open up and the Father declares, "This is my Son," and the Spirit descends in the form of a dove, is that Jesus, the man, is being adopted to be the Savior. He was then also adopted into union with the Godhead. So there is a very high view of humanity here, but Jesus is a mere human who is adopted as divine at the baptism. You can see how this would make sense in the Roman Empire, and especially why it makes sense that this was popular in Latin-speaking Rome. The Roman emperors had long established the habit, beginning with Caesar himself, of rather than using one of their natural sons, adopting a son who would inherit the throne. So the concept of a supreme ruler adopting an heir is very common, and it fits with a cultural tendency in the Greco-Roman mind, which was established well by the time of the end of the second century. So this was popular, especially in Latin-speaking Rome, but the tendency is to read the scriptures and emphasize those parts where Jesus claims to be one with the Father, and this one with the Father is an act of adoption, not an act of being fully one with the Father. So it's interesting to read that, where Jesus claims, "I and the Father are one." This is read in terms of the adoption of Christ by the Father. The second answer, occurring just a bit later, was the followers of Noetus, the Noetians, or if you find Noetians a bit difficult to say, they, for convenience, are also called the Patripassians. So Noetianism or Patripassianism. In other words, there is no really good shorthand word for this. Jesus was nothing other than the one true God, no different from the Father, who came to earth to suffer and die. Therefore, what happened on the cross is the Father, God the Father, came to earth, suffered, and died, and then rose again on the third day. So it obtains the name Patripassian from the idea that Patri, the Father, Passia, suffers. The Father suffers. So the Noetians are the second portion of that. Ironically, they too emphasize those parts of Scripture where Jesus claims to be one with the Father, and it seems to make more sense to my mind that they would, because here, since they are exactly the same thing, the idea of unity is far more literal. Both of these movements, and particularly the Adoptionists, but both of these movements tended to think in terms of Aristotelian categories and be very fond of Aristotle. The textbook makes this sound like this makes them intellectuals vis-a-vis the church in Rome. I don't think that you can really say that Hippolytus or his sometime adversary Callistus in Rome were not intellectuals. I think they were far more sophisticated intellectuals than the tanner from Byzantium. But what they weren't is Aristotelians. As you will find in later discussions, there's a great difference between people who gravitate toward Aristotelian categories and Aristotelian logical solutions to things and the Christian movement, particularly as it occurred in the East, which gravitated a bit more toward the flexibility of mind, which is typically associated with Plato. Plato and Aristotle have profound differences, if you don't know, And one of those differences is that Aristotle tends toward tidy categories and logical explanation, whereas Plato allows for a great deal more flexibility, the limitations of human language, and the possibility of strict logic as conceived by the human mind, not pertaining to things which transcend. So just some basic points that I want you to bear in mind for future discussion as well, because this will come into question with the division of the Latin Western Church and the Greek Eastern Church. The Greek Eastern Church has a mindset which gravitates quite a bit more toward Plato than the Latin Church for a number of reasons. The Latin Church tends to, after the first millennium, have a bias toward certain Aristotelian ideas for reasons of Aristotle's writings being recovered in the age of Scholasticism and a number of other things, including the Latin language accommodating an Aristotelian worldview, I would suggest, better than the Greek does. So these things I want you to hold on to, but this idea that God has to be subject to human reason in the Monarchians is one of the keys that comes from Aristotle and makes them heretics in both Eastern and Western churches for, well, the rest of the existence of Christianity, I should expect. The third answer, and this is an interesting one because I hear this type of thinking coming from an awful lot of sermons in modern-day Christianity, including from the occasional Orthodox pulpit where I worship. We don't actually have a pulpit, it's more a figure of speech, folks. The priest simply stands in front of everybody and preaches. But the third is Sabellianism, followers of Sabellius. Very little is known about him other than the teachings that are associated with him. This one is a bit more subtle, and this is one that modern Christians tend to fall into on a regular basis, but it was regarded as just the same type of problem as the other Monarchian movements, and no less a heresy by the majority of Christians in the 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and up through, you know, I suppose early Protestantism, the first millennium or more after the founding of Sabellianism. This is the idea that Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are just three different modes or masks of God, three different ways in which the one true God appears and deals with humans. You hear this in sermons a lot as God the Father is the Creator, God the Son is the Redeemer, and God the Spirit is the Sanctifier, and it's just three different ways that one God operates in relating to humans. Boy, that every time you hear it, that is a heresy condemned repeatedly in the early church. You also hear analogies which are inherently Sabellian or modalist, that the Trinity is like water, which exists both as ice and water and steam. Okay, there are three different modes of water, so also there are three different ways of God being. That also is Sabellian heresy, because it the only division then between Father, Son, and Spirit is one of mode rather than actual person. And that's something that the scriptures don't support in the reading of mainline Christianity from the second century onward. You hear it also in the analogy of an apple. Okay, even as an apple has a core, some flesh, and a skin, so also God is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Right. Also modalism, because the apple, and this is, there's a book put out, unfortunately, by the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, which uses this analogy. The Missouri Synod otherwise gets the Trinity pretty darn straight on a regular basis. That's where I got my training, as you know, folks. And I learned at the hands of true masters of this type of stuff, if there are such. To be truthful, what you're a master of if you study the Trinity is a master of simply not saying so much that you've created heresy again. We'll talk about that more later. Nobody understands the Trinity. All three of these errors were condemned not because they didn't make sense. That's not the point. They are condemned because they run counter to the very idea of God transcending human reason. If you have the Trinity figured out, if you have the distinctions between Father and Son and Holy Spirit figured out, then you have reduced God to something which is comprehensible by human reason and therefore is not God. God by nature must transcend human reason, which is why the concept of a Trinity is not illogical to early Christians. if the Trinity were comprehensible, then God, according to God's nature, would be subject to human reason and no longer transcendent, no longer God, but an object which could be put beneath the intellectual microscope and studied like any other object can be studied. Ask questions on that one, boy, that gets me rolling. But, so it's interesting. The point is not that these don't make sense. There are two points here that bother the Christians in the second, third, fourth, and all the way through Luther, Calvin, and most mainline Christians today, I guess, maybe still. I hear an awful lot of Sabellianism and even adoptionism coming from modern Christians. What bothered them was two things. First, you have intellectually reduced the mystery of God to human reason, and second, all three of these interpretations countered the received testimony of what are increasingly regarded as the authoritative apostolic scriptures of the early church. So all of these are condemned by mainstream Christians as heresy, if you want to use mainstream as referring to the simple, you know, majority Christians the way I have, the proto-Orthodox, then fine. You may personally side with one of the minorities, and you're welcome to do so, I don't care. But there is a discernible group, all of whom regard these as errors. They're regarded as heresies for denying parts of the apostolic message in the scriptures, and more specifically, for over-rationalizing the definition of God, which is inherently a transcendent mystery. At this point, it's important to address one of the most common questions among history students. So what? What difference does this make? In the case of Christianity, the answer to this is fairly profound, and it goes back to the questions which I told you are at the very heart of the Gospel of Mark in chapter 8. Who is Jesus Christ, and what did he come to do? According to the majority opinion that rejects the Monarchian movements, the Monarchians have gotten both of these questions wrong to one degree or another. Who is Jesus Christ? If he's a mere human, that changes a great deal the question of the nature of how God relates to humanity through Jesus becoming incarnate. If Jesus Christ is God the Father himself, then it raises some real questions about Jesus talking to himself in the Gospel of John and seeming to have a bizarre split personality. And it raises questions about what he came to do as well. Was Jesus the incarnate Son of God, equal to the Father, who came to save humans by participating in human death and then introducing a new concept to humanity, the concept of resurrection? Or was Jesus simply a creature created by the Father to rescue other creatures? Human nature and how humans relate to God are at stake in the answers to these questions. When it comes to Sabellianism, there are even more profound problems of if God the Father is just God acting as creator, God the Son is God acting as redeemer, then how do we explain passages in the scriptures like relating to God the Son? In him we live, move, and have our being. Okay? And this seems to be a specifically Son-oriented thing. Or for him, by him, and through him were all things made. Parallel concepts which suggest that the Son had a participatory act in creation, and the idea that was already espoused by a lot of early Christian thinkers, that what you have in the Genesis account is the Word being spoken, the breath being that which bears the Word, and Father, Son, and Holy Spirit all participating in the act of creation. And you also have the problem of, in the case of Sabellianism, that you have with Patripassianism of when Jesus is talking to the Father, is he just some bizarre multiple personality critter that wanders around talking to himself for the sake of his disciples? It sure doesn't read that way in the text. It reads as if Father and Son are carrying on a conversation, but you're only hearing one half of that phone conversation, the half spoken by the Son. So there's a lot of problems if you accept the scriptures as determining who God is, with all three of these ideas. Raise more questions, and I will have more scriptures to discuss with you, or, you know, ask about what I've said here. For the sake of time, and since this is just a mere recording, let's move on. What the debates of the second and third centuries revealed was the inherent philosophical tension in being monotheist, being a single God, and claiming that Jesus is somehow divine along with the Father. This is a philosophical tension which inheres with an Aristotelian mindset. I will throw that out again. And it also is more of a hobgoblin to the modern thinker, who believes bizarre things like two things can't inhabit the same place and one thing can't be two things, than it does to the ancient thinker, who had a much more flexible mind in this regard. Math and physics types, you'd feel more at home with your bizarre definitions of things like electrons being both particles and waves. You'd feel more at home with the flexibility of mind, I think, that you find in the ancient world than with the average supermarket philosophy, as I call it, which is bought off the shelf today. The variety of explanations erupted into more debates when Christianity was legalized in the 4th century. I just want you to hold on to that concept, because by the 4th century, monarchianism has pretty much been set aside. There are a few monarchians left, as you know, you can ask about when we get to the 4th century, which is at the other end of Lecture 5. But for now, just hold on to the idea that these debates, even though they're addressed and perhaps even settled by the 2nd and 3rd century church, these debates lead to other debates. It's truly a domino effect. And when we get to Arianism, and you're going to know and love Arianism by the time we're done with it, when we get to Arianism, you'll have a much greater context for how this worked. A central rule in everything was to maintain the fact among Christians that the way God actually is a transcendent mystery which appears to the human perception as a paradox. Since God transcends human reason, it is necessary that God can only appear paradoxical to humans. God must be more sophisticated than the human intellect can understand, or God would not transcend the human intellect. Another central rule, and you can see the importance now of how the appeal to canon, which develops in response to the earlier heresies of Marcion and the Gnostics, another central rule was the scriptures had revealed the nature of the Trinity as far as it could or even should be understood. The scriptures are sufficient for any human discussion of the Trinity. Go beyond what the apostles and prophets, because they believed there was a Trinitarian message by the prophets among the Trinitarians as they developed, go beyond the apostles and prophets, and you go beyond what the limits of acceptable discussion really are. They've given you the guidelines. The Old and New Testaments have given you the guidelines for how to discuss God. The problem is, first, how do you interpret what the scriptures say? It's still a problem today, as you know. I've taken on any number of scriptural interpretations, especially those that have no connection whatsoever to how the Greek actually reads. So how do you interpret what the scriptures say? And second, when have you gone too far in explaining a mystery? Hold on to that thought, because when Arius and his followers come on the scene in the 4th century, one of the first things charged against them is that they have gone too far in their explanation, subjecting what comes to be known as the Trinity, Father, Son, and Spirit, to categories of human reason once again. Now, I want to take issue, I always want to take issue with the textbook, but here especially, it kind of annoys me. There's a lot of things that annoy me. The textbooks claim that Tertullian and his disciple Novatian came closest, in the textbook's words on page 86, came closest to explaining how the paradox of the Trinity could be reconciled, places far too much focus on the Western concerns of reconciling a mystery with logic. I don't want to slam Tertullian here, because his work on the Trinity, along with his Against Proxius, are some of his most profound and influential texts, and they are quite good at defining the debate with the Monarchians. So what I do want to make clear, though, is that Tertullian proceeds in a very lawyerly, legal fashion. Now, this appeals to the Western mind, but the Eastern mind finds it repulsive. The Eastern mind, guided by a far more flexible approach to theology, does not like the tidy categories which are being forged by Tertullian. The East will accuse Tertullian, in addition to being a Montanist and a heretic, of being borderline on that problem of over-rationalizing a mystery. For us, in the East, we don't suffer quite the same way as Tertullian from the desire to have tidy answers. Easy answers, that might be pushing it, because Tertullian's answers aren't easy. But why does he need answers at all when what he's dealing with is transcendence? All you can do is reason about how not to speak of something, how to avoid error, in other words. For us in the East, Origen and his teacher Clement of Alexandria did a far better job than Tertullian of staking out the boundaries of a mystery, which is only mystery because the human mind is confined to space and time and to its creatureliness, while God is not. The God as Trinity is not mystery to God, nor is it problematic to God, coming from an Eastern way of reasoning. It's problematic to humans because of the limitations of being a creature, and particularly those limitations which confine us to space and time, when God is not so confined. This is where the textbook goofs up with Justin Martyr, as I mentioned earlier, by suggesting that Justin sees Christ as confined to time. I don't see that at all in Justin. Justin is a far more Eastern thinker that way. The issues here are really more profound than you might realize, and this is brought up in serious theological debates between Eastern and Western Christians when we get, not surprisingly, to the discussion of the Trinity. The West will reason according to categories. The East will reason according to analogy. And so we are quite literally talking past each other. We see it as a defect that the West needs to understand things which are beyond human understanding. The West will also suggest that Origen was a heretic, which he was, but for reasons very different than the question of the Trinity. And that means we need to talk a little bit about what the textbook gets wrong, as far as I'm concerned, in its summary of Origen and Clement, the Alexandrian school, as they are called in Chapter 9. Before we get on to just a brief discussion, and it will be brief, unfortunately, of what Clement and of Alexandria did, along with Origen, in moving Christianity forward toward an acceptable set of answers regarding the Trinity, I want to point out some of the beefs I have now with textbook chapter 9. This is head-scratchingly bizarre. I find it odd that the textbook should assert that Alexandrian Christianity prior to Clement was somehow simple. That seems to be wishful thinking. Or perhaps, you know, you could make it as simple as just a pure guess on the part of the textbook. But I think it's actually wishful thinking on the part of textbook editors who would like to have this kind of a myth of a happy, simple Christianity that began in the first century, which gets muddied by complex thinkers in the second and third centuries, and hence the purity of this early kumbaya singing group of Jesus following hippies is disturbed by people thinking too deeply. There is nothing simple about anything in Alexandria. The Jewish community long before Christianity in Alexandria was profoundly engaged with Hellenic concepts and Plato. The Jewish writer that I read an awful lot of, Philo of Alexandria, there's nothing simple about Philo. There's certainly nothing simple about the church at the time of Clement. And that makes me wonder just how on earth there could be anything fairly simple and shallow about the church prior to Clement. That he seems to be a very much a product of his Alexandrian environment. So let's be a bit more historical and assume that Clement actually reflects the Church of Alexandria rather than taking it in a new direction when there is no evidence for the latter position whatsoever. Clement himself suggests that the unity between Greek philosophical language and Christianity was something he inherited from those who went before him. If he also developed it, which is true, he acknowledges his debt to previous generations of Alexandrians, and I would say that goes all the way back to Philo and the Jewish community that wrestled with Platonic ideas in Alexandria. You know my position that people who separate the Jewish community from the Christian community at this phase of history are overstating the case if they separate them too profoundly. The Christians struggled to define themselves as separate from a Jewish matrix, but it's doubtful, because they struggled so hard for so many centuries, it's doubtful that that recognition would have been clear to observers in the second and third centuries, either Jewish observers, as Adi Schremer argues in his book Brothers Estranged, or to Roman observers who seemed rather disinterested in the whole thing, with the exception that Christians are a particularly detestable bunch for their inability to work with the Romans in questions relating to the state, as you saw in Justin the Martyr. So these two communities need to understand the Christian community in light of the Jewish matrix, particularly in Alexandria, because the Christian thinking so clearly reflects the Hellenistic Jewish thinking in Alexandria of previous generations that the connection, particularly since Christianity grows out of Judaism, the connection should be obvious. We've already observed, again, much to this disturbance of Christians who like to think of their movement in its early years as simple and uncomplicated and a bunch of happy, Jesus-loving people, we've already observed that Greek philosophy is present in the earliest books of the New Testament, in the writings of the Apostle Paul, and this is made clear in chapter 16 of the textbook also. Wishful thinking aside, other editors and other authors of Williston Walker acknowledge Christianity's reliance upon philosophical categories. Assuming a radical distinction between Greek philosophy and Christianity then probably reveals more about the textbook authors than about Alexandria, because such a thing never existed in Alexandria, I will maintain. There's another really bizarre phenomenon in the textbook, and that's the use of the word sola scriptura on page 90 to suggest that Origen, and by extension Clement, as I recall from page 90, let me check that out, really bizarre, that Origen somehow has this sola scriptura doctrine, Bible alone. Whoa, I don't see anything in Origen that looks remotely like sola scriptura. Those of you in this class who may have been raised in very Bible-believing churches, no matter what your current opinions are going to read Origen and be aghast at what he does with your beloved Bible. There's nothing simple about his reading of the scriptures, and it's clear that for Origen, the scriptures are not the sole source of authority in just about anything. They may be supreme in matters of the faith, but there's nothing coming close to that. So all I can tell you is this shows a certain Protestant bias of the authors of the textbook. But to be fair to Protestants, such as Lutherans, the sola scriptura doctrine didn't exist in Lutheranism either. Sorry if this offends you. In fact, I kind of hope it offends you if you are Lutheran and listening to this, at the time of the Reformation. Louis Spitz, you can look up who Louis Spitz is online, but he is a Reformation scholar and a very good one, or he was a Reformation scholar when he was alive. Louis Spitz, riding around in the back of my 1980, whatever it was, Ford station wagon, walked me through the whole claim of a Protestant doctrine of sola scriptura. You don't find it in Luther, you don't find it in Calvin, the idea that the scriptures alone are sufficient for anything more than the questions of faith. They are not alone the authority in the faith, they are the supreme authority of this faith. The scriptures have to be interpreted, however, in terms of other authorities. So there are many authorities for both Calvinists and Lutherans. And by the time Louis Spitz got done with me, I decided, if not a firm convert to his point of view, I was at least at a point where I had to read all of the writings of Luther, which I did, in German and my halting Latin. And I found out he's right. The words don't exist anywhere in Luther, nor can you say that the concept in its strict sense exists there either. So this is a very late addition to Christianity, and one which, when you hear it, it can be interpreted correctly, and the Missouri Synod crowd has reinterpreted the idea of sola scriptura in such a way that it's consistent with Lutheran thinking. It is nevertheless an anachronism, even for the Reformation. Now, if it's an anachronism for the Reformation, folks, you know it's an anachronism for the 3rd century. And indeed it is. There is nothing in Origen that comes close to anything that would make a Protestant comfortable. Origen was obsessed with getting the message of the apostolic scriptures right, and this may be what they're referring to. Origen was an tireless Bible scholar. But as we have seen, he was far from alone. There are a lot of Christians who are obsessed with getting the apostolic message right. That's what, if nothing else, the challenge of Gnosticism and the Marcionites launched the Christians into. So he did not confine himself to any such thing as literal meaning. I have told you before, and I will tell you again, that in neither Greek nor Hebrew is there a word or even a phrase that equates to the way we use the word literal today. It's certainly foreign to the Greek mind. It's certainly foreign to the Greek mind which reasons by analogy. The concept of literalness is much more comfortable to the Latin mind than it is to the Greek mind. When I do draw distinctions between the Latin mind and the Greek mind, by the way, I don't want to suggest the inherent superiority of the Greek way of thinking. What I do want to suggest is the inherent difference that separates my biases as an Eastern-thinking Christian from the biases you're going to find when you talk with Western-thinking Christians. To be fair, there is nothing inherently heretical about thinking in terms of Latin theology. To be fair, there is nothing inherently correct about thinking along the terms of Eastern theology. What you do with it is what makes the difference, and I invite you to ask me about that more if you care. It's also not common for scholars to see subordinationism in Origen, at least the way the textbook describes it, except when he was misread. There is something of a rehabilitation of Origen going on in the present generation, where biases against Origen, and there are quite a few, Origen is regarded as a heretic. So biases against Origen lead people to try to blame Origen for a great many things of which scholars are now finding he was never guilty. And one of them, I think, is subordinationism. I believe quite profoundly that you can't truly make Origen into a subordinationist. He was a heretic at a number of levels, the same way Tertullian was a heretic when he's a Montanist, but not in regard to the Trinity. But Origen is not a heretic in regard to the Trinity either. The heresies associated with Originism, and I'm not sure that he believed them as firmly as some of his followers apparently did, the heresies associated with Originism were the belief in an eternal physical world, a la Plato, that there wasn't a true creation of the world, but it existed eternally, and the belief in the pre-existence of the soul. Origen engaged in both these ideas as kind of a mere speculation, the idea that the soul pre-exists the human body, and that souls are placed into a human body, kind of a transmigration idea, at least in one sense of happening once, and the eternality of the world. Origen engages in speculation on these, but did he maintain them as absolute doctrines? I don't think that's being fair to Origen. It may be true of some of the people who read Origen after him and adopted these ideas as their own. And so Originism, significantly, is condemned as a heresy a few centuries later. That being said, okay, if these are the problems with Origen, then you can't really you can't really fault him for other things inherently unless he got those wrong as well. But I do think there's a bias in discussing Origen. There's a lot of Origen gets a lot of crap from later theologians and thinkers, from later Christian movements, and I think a lot of that is not justified. Feel free to ask me about Origen at your leisure as well. At this point, students start dropping off and not caring anymore, but very few people get passionate about Origen the way I do, which is why I insert the next point about Origen, which kind of wakes folks up again. Another thing that's held against Origen, and another reason that Christians of all stripes can take a fairly dim view of him, is that he practiced an early philosophical habit. Wasn't extremely common among anybody, I think, for obvious reasons, but it was done in the ancient world. Origen had himself castrated. That caused a very different reaction than accusations of heresy. It caused the kind of same leg-crossing cringe that I get from students today when I talk about Origen, thinking philosophically, should I keep my genitals or should I not keep my genitals, and deciding that he'd be better off without them. Woo, ouch. Yeah, in a day before anesthetics, too. So many things can be wrong with that scenario that it's hard to summarize them. From Origen's perspective, his sex drive was simply a distraction from more important things. Now, is this acceptable in Christianity? No, it completely violates the concept that is dominant in early Christianity, that one should accept the body which one is given in fashioning, and that you shouldn't take Jesus too literally when he says, if this or that part of your body causes you to sin, cut it off. So there you go. Feel free to ask questions about anything, but Origen's castration, I am happy to answer. So let's talk a bit about what Clement and Origen did, because the textbook, I don't think, allows their influence to be as significant as it truly was in history. First, between Clement and Origen, and this is not true of Tertullian, Clement and Origen developed a pattern of languages in which paradoxes could be expressed without favoring one feature over another. The point of a paradox is not that it can be logically resolved. The point of a paradox is that it may be spoken while retaining an equal balance of the two things which contradict according to a shallow human reason. Divinity versus unity, the multiple divinity of Christ and the Father and the Holy Spirit versus the unity of all three as a single God. These paradoxes need a way to be pronounced, a way to be discussed so that you don't err on one side or another. This is an important point, and I think it's true. And one of my Lutheran seminary professors pointed out that the surest way to become a heretic is to keep talking about the Trinity. If you say too many things about the Trinity, eventually you're going to say something which goes beyond the boundaries of acceptable ways of discussing the Trinity. You will, if you keep talking, over-rationalize the Trinity. At the risk of keeping talking, now I'm not talking about the Trinity, I want to point out, but I'm talking about the Trinity, I should move on. Clement and Origen again clarified the compatibility of Christian revelation with Greek philosophy. This is especially when Clement allowed that Greek philosophers were given their insights as preparation for Christianity. You saw that in Justin the Martyr. You saw that when I referred to Paul in Acts 17. The reason the Greeks were allowed spiritual insights, including in their mythology, not simply confined to their philosophy, the reason that they were allowed spiritual insights was to prepare them for the gospel, and it is not then wrong to acknowledge what God gave to the Greeks, which is a certain clear thinking and a certain linguistic sophistication, as a tool of the God who created it in the first place. Origen especially developed a pattern of language which discussed God as transcendent of space and time in such a way that time-bound arguments used by the Monarchians could be dismissed. Was Jesus created in time? Did Jesus develop and was he adopted in time? Is there a point where God exists without Jesus? Is there a point where the one God who is Father and Son can be referred to as one term rather than two? The point of God transcending space and time means that God's transcendence solves these problems. This also solves problems which would arise later in the church, such as the problem of predestination. A God transcendent of time is not bound to language such as before and after. We'll bend your brain with that one before the third test. Origen, especially again, provided a pattern of language for discussing Christ as second to the Father in that he proceeded from the ultimate source, but equal to and united with the Father according to will and divinity. This goes back to the candle and light analogy. The light proceeds from the source, but the light cannot exist without the source, and the source necessarily has the light attached. Now, in using the word necessarily, I've also waded into some Trinitarian discussions that I probably shouldn't have. But as the procession of Son from Father occurred outside of time, there is no before and after hierarchy between the Father and the Son, only one of procession. The Father did not exist before the Son. The Son did not come after the Father, because before and after cannot be applied to a God who transcends time. The procession of light from its source, the procession of Christ from his source, the Father, is only understood as a distinction between source and that which proceeds from source, as the Son. The impact here on the question of the Holy Spirit, you'll see in the Creed of 381, when we get to the end of our discussion of the Trinitarian issues. But this language is what is used in defining those debates. The suggestion that Arius and Arianism particularly used Origen, I think, ignores the way in which Origen influenced all of the players in the later Christological debates. In the same way, then, the Holy Spirit, you will see, can be discussed as proceeding, but the Spirit merely proceeds where there is a separate relationship between Father and Son in which the Logos is begotten. And to say this happens in time is to confine the transcendent God to something he created, which is time itself. Origen also developed a formal manner of reading the scriptures, which would make most of you Protestants pretty uncomfortable, to be honest, in which these principles are central throughout the Old and New Testaments. The idea of the procession of the Son from the Father and the idea of Christ being incarnate are the basic truth behind all of the scriptures. Now, insofar as that goes, this is precisely what Martin Luther meant when he talked about the single sense of the scriptures being literal, sensus in literalis unus est, or the literal sense being singular. He did not mean a literal sense the way we think of literal today. Martin Luther meant that all of the Old and New Testament refers to the procession of the Son from the Father and the procession of the Spirit from Father and for him, for Father and Son. Luther wanted his audience to understand that the scriptures have one message, and that message is the coming of Christ. In other words, for Luther, what I've suggested is the central message of the Gospel of Mark in chapter 8, who is Jesus and what did he come to do? For Luther, that was the central message of the entire scriptures, and that was true for Origen as well. This idea that the Old Testament and the New Testament, the way we talk about them today, they were simply called the Scriptures and then the Apostolic Writings at the time, the Old and New Testaments have one message, and that message is the incarnation of Christ, means that the single questions, the twofold question that we pointed out at the center of Mark, who is Jesus and what did he come to do, are not only the central message of Mark, but the central message of all Scripture. That, if it wasn't held clearly before this time, that from this time onward is the conviction of the Christian movement. We had a professor at my seminary as a Lutheran who said something very accurate, and he was attacked for it, but he said something very accurate. All theology is Christology. for Christians. If that's not true, then there is a message in the scriptures other than the coming of Christ and the meaning of that coming. And that, in the early church, would be heresy. Origen is the person who articulates this, I believe, clearly. So there you have it. Those are some really deep concepts, and I will not claim to have done them justice sitting here in the shack of knowledge, drinking coffee, and boy, I need to stoke the fire again because it's getting a little cold. It dropped below my usual 45 just now. So I'm going to tend the fire before moving on to any other lectures. Do ask any questions you may have, and I promise you the next lecture will not be quite so weighty. We're going to talk about the persecutions, a little more straight-up history, the persecutions that end the 3rd and begin the 4th century, the period when persecutions become their most fierce. So until we talk about that, I'll see you later.